I'm going to come right in with a very distinguished guest who's gotten to be sort of an email buddy of mine. I'm talking about former Governor Mike Huckabee, who is one of the front-running presidential contenders for the Republican nomination for quite some time, and only recently announced that for his own spiritual reasons, his own inward reasons, he's decided not to run. He is an extremely popular broadcaster with a very, very highly rated weekend show, Huckabee, that is one of my favorites to watch on the weekend. I've been a guest on it a couple of times. Welcome, former Governor Mike Huckabee of Arkansas. Welcome, Mike Huckabee, to the Lisa Wexler Show today.
Thank you, Lisa. Great to be with you today.
Well, it's really nice of you to be on the show. And I was very interested in reading. I know you've had a lot of bestsellers, and you've had a career in broadcasting and as a pastor that's really very much about communicating your values to the American public, to your audience. And I thought what was most interesting about your statement in which you decided not to run is that you said that it was a result of a spiritual decision. And I wanted to ask you, were you looking for some kind of a sign to decide yes?
You know, Lisa, sometimes it's hard to explain things that are deep within you, and this is one of those areas where I just knew in my heart of hearts that even though the circumstances, frankly, looked very favorable for me to run, just something inside me was unsettled. And I've come to learn through the years, particularly in my faith as a Christian, that when there's not that peace, that sense of being settled and at totally at ease with it, best to walk away. And I don't expect a lot of people to understand that completely, but I know that that's the way it is. And I can tell you a lot of human reasons that I think that were factors in my ultimately deciding not to run. There are a lot of human factors that certainly pointed that I should. But there's an old saying, and put it simply, when in doubt, don't.
So in the past, because you ran for governor, you were governor for what, 11 years? A long time.
Yeah, almost 11 years.
Almost 11 years. What was sort of the spiritual drive then that was missing from the presidential?
Interesting, even 4 years ago when I ran for president, that's when there were really no favorable factors. People thought I was nuts to run. They said, nobody knows you. You don't have any big political organization. You don't have a national base or a national ID. But I knew in my heart that, yeah, do it. When I ran for public office the very first time, which was 20 years ago, again, it did not appear from an external perspective to be a very smart decision. But I had that peace about it. And so this is almost the polar opposite. I'm not saying that, gosh, if everything looks good, don't do it. If everything looks bad, go ahead and do it. But I just have learned through the years, and it's not just with political decisions, but with all decisions, do what you can put your head on the pillow at night and go perfectly to sleep with and be at ease. And as I told Chris Wallace the next day, after the announcement on Saturday night, I said, Chris, I slept well last night. And that's the best way I can describe.
So let me ask you this, Mike. Is it possible your spiritual decision was guided by a higher power who really wants Barack Obama to make it his second term?
Oh, I hope not, Lisa. From my perspective, I hope not. And I'm hoping it's just that maybe I was one more obstacle to keep maybe some good Republican that will be better than me. And I don't know who that is. People have asked me who I'm endorsing, and no one yet. I'm going to wait and see how the field emerges. But it certainly wasn't because I wanted Barack Obama to be president again.
Do you think he's done anything right?
I think he's been and I don't mean to be facetious, but to me this is important. I think he's been a wonderful husband and father, a good role model for America, for America's dads.
I agree with that.
And America's husbands. And I appreciate that, and that's not a small thing to me, because in a country where half the marriages end in divorce, where you have so many young men who grow up not even knowing who their father is and having no relationship with him, I think it is a wonderful role model for the president to show how much he adores his wife. He dotes on his daughters. He's loyal to them. They have a wonderful relationship, and I think that's admirable. I think his decision to kill Osama bin Laden was brilliant, and it was brilliant in part because it was risky. The politically easy thing to do would have been to bomb the place. The risk that we're fraught about going in there as he did with the SEAL team was extraordinary. And he literally put his political life on the line in that decision. And that showed a level of courage that I had not seen in him up until that moment. And I was very happy about that.
Yeah, I agree with those two things. And especially given the personal histories, peccadilloes, and failings of so many other people that decide to run for president, he actually stands in sharp contrast to a lot of his opposition, both that were Democrats and that are currently Republicans.
And I do think that there's something to be said for people who keep the promises to the people that are closest to them. If a person doesn't keep promises to the people they're closest to, the people to whom they vowed before God and each other that they will keep a promise to, how then can I, as a total stranger, expect that politician to keep a promise to me? Obviously, I don't. You know, I'll assume he'll do whatever he can do to get what he wants. And so I do think that, and one of the things I believe very strongly, that the most important form of government is not Congress and it's not the state house or even city council. The most important form of government is still a family. That's where we are first governed as children. And our first laws are met not at the police station. We meet them at home when mother and dad tells us what we have to do and what the law is at that house. And that is a form of government that we need to get right. And if we don't, then all the other forms of government are going to get a lot more complicated and a lot more expensive.
And I think that the trend is so clearly already in that direction. We have more and more unwed couples. I've written about unwed celebrity couples. I took a lot of flack about that, but so be it. I see that we are a country where increasingly our young people, maybe they always were influenced by movie stars like Elizabeth Taylor, I don't know, but increasingly our pseudo-celebrity, pseudo-fame culture elevates people of no real accomplishment or talent, except that they maybe made a sex video. And so we have all these people flashing in front of our young people that are very often the poorest of moral role models. But then you have the occasional very accomplished actress or so. And it's simply just okay because nobody wants to, God forbid, question anybody's judgment in parading about the value of, you know, being triumphant as a single mom. And believe me, I'm not castigating people who find themselves as single moms by any means, by any means. I just think that it should be recognized that for a child, a mother and a father, two loving parents, are an ideal that shouldn't be scoffed at like, you know, an old shoe, like the father isn't important.
Well, Lisa, it's very refreshing to hear someone else say that because it's what I deeply believe. And I, like you, have been in trouble because I have spoken out about the fact that while a Hollywood celebrity certainly has the resources to hire nannies and provide a good, great education for a child, even though the celebrity may be single, that is not the typical single parent situation. My own wife was raised by a single mom who, to me, brilliantly raised five children by herself. But it was tough. And the hard reality is that statistically, children raised by a single parent without benefit of both has a 70% greater likelihood of being a juvenile delinquent, far more likely to smoke, use alcohol or drugs, be sexually promiscuous. I'm not saying that all children from single parent homes will, because that's not true. We know too many success stories. But I'm just saying statistically, the odds are far more in favor of a kid making it if that child has both a mother and a father in a stable environment where the two parents share the responsibilities of raising the child and give them both a role model of both the father and the mother. One thing we know, there is a $300 billion a year dad deficit in America. That's how much money taxpayers, this is not about issue that doesn't touch the economy, but taxpayers are on the lam for $300 billion a year in America, and that's the cost that government pays to pick up the pieces for fathers being absent in their children's life. That's really quantifiable, and that's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money, and also, you know, I know that I am who I am. I mean, I have a terrific set of parents, a mother and a father, but there are a lot of women, and consistently in interviews of accomplished women, successful women, a lot of their core self-esteem comes from having a father, not a mother, tell them that they could do it. And I just think that the role of men in child raising has just been discounted, married or not. I just think it's been discounted too much.
Fathers are almost treated as, expendables that, we can have the child artificially created in the test tube. So the father is basically a sperm donor, but even that doesn't have to require a personal presence to the mother. And all of these things combine to give us the sense of, a false sense of independence. When really, the ideal family structure gives the children both a female and a male role model to teach them the role that each plays in that family relationship. And I do fear that we've almost acted not only that parents are expendable, but that children are collectibles. It bothers me when I hear people say, well, I'm not married, but I want to have a baby. Well, having a baby is not the same as adopting a hamster. And I know I'm going to have somebody say, Mike Huckabee says babies are like hamsters. That's not what I'm saying. This is a metaphor.
Right.
To all your listeners and to the people at Media Matters who watch and listen to everything I say and go berserk, I want them to know, because they are not only clueless, but they are humorless. So let me tell them now. I'm speaking metaphorically.
Yes, I understand that. I understand that. I'm speaking with former Governor Mike Huckabee of Arkansas, who is really a very, very popular person, not only in the political scene, but in the broadcasting scene. And I do want to say that I like your show, not only for its entertainment value, but we discussed this off the air. I like it because it has a point of view. I like the fact that your point of view comes across in your TV show. I got to ask you, because I know you've been to Israel pretty recently, actually. What was your reaction to both President Obama's speech, which caused a furor, I will tell you, and no less than that in the Jewish community, and then the reaction the next day of Benjamin Netanyahu, which seems to have caused a kickback? I've heard some conservative talk radio hosts say that they thought that he was disrespectful to the president, which I didn't see, and I didn't agree with. And then I don't know if you followed the speeches at AIPAC, but I'm just curious what you make of all of this.
Well, Lisa, I've been to Israel 15 times. First time was in 1973, just before the Yom Kippur War. I've been over the years, time and time again. I know Benjamin Netanyahu very well. I was just there in February. My reaction to the president's speech was absolute shock and horror that a United States president would abandon the one decent friend we have in the Middle East and one of the few we have in the entire world and show a betrayal of trust that has existed between our countries. I was livid, and frankly, I still am. For him to have the audacity to suggest that we move the borders back to pre-67 is the equivalent of saying that we're going to try to have some type of peaceful arrangement with Mexico, and we're going to give half of Texas back. That is absurd. And I was insulted as an American, and I was embarrassed as an American that we would even suggest such a ridiculous thing to let terrorist organizations like Hamas move that much closer to the bedrooms of Israeli children. When the Prime Minister spoke, both at the White House and beyond, I think he has shown a level of statesmanship and candor that for me is very refreshing in political life. Typically, in a moment like that, you would see a lot of obligatory handshakes and smiles, handing it up for the cameras, and no real honesty. What Netanyahu did was to take Barack Obama to school, and he did it in a gentle, polite, but incredibly firm way, and basically remind him that Israel is not fighting for a piece of land. They're fighting for their very lives. Theirs is not an issue of geography. Theirs is an issue of survival. And how dare the president suggest that there's just this little issue of a few pieces of land and some acreage, and we'll swap those out and make everybody happy. The president needs to kind of, as they say, wake up and smell the espresso on this one. And the fact is, this is not an issue over geography. This is an issue over whether or not Israel has a right to exist. The Palestinians have never, ever acknowledged that they did. And I thought that Netanyahu's speech today to the joint session of Congress.
I heard it was, I haven't heard the speech yet. I heard it was filled with standing ovations. I heard it was unbelievable.
It was one of the finest speeches I think I have heard perhaps in my lifetime. It will rank, I'm convinced, with Reagan's speech, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall,
really?
And many others, as laying out the case for why Israel and the United States have such a close organic relationship. And I hope the president will listen carefully to it. He needs to hear the substance of the speech, not just the style, But the substance of that speech was absolutely amazing.
I got to hear it. I got to listen to it myself. I missed it today. I just missed it. But I have heard from people that were there that it was just extraordinary. And so, you know, and the thing about Israelis is, number one, they're not known for their diplomacy per se anyway. I mean, look, you know Israelis. You've been there 15 times. I mean, you don't want to be shopping with them, if you know what I'm saying. I mean, they'll elbow you right out of the way. But, you know, this comes from the survival thing. They have no time. You know, they can't waste it with diplomacy and nice words. They're always fighting for their survival.
Well, the Israeli people have the history of being hunted down and almost literally obliterated by evil. Like you say, they cannot suffer fools who think that this is sort of a trifling, traditional, typical, and ordinary diplomatic matter. They know that if they do not stand tall, firm, and unyielding, they will once again see the kind of horrors that they saw during the Third Reich.
Well, before I let you go, I just want to ask you, if you were president now, and as somebody who is definitely a leader in this country, what would you do to stave off this looming unilateral declaration in the UN that's coming in September, which will be supported by the European Union for sure, and which it seems to me that President Obama, I think he's going to waver on when it comes to veto. And even if he vetoes it, we will be in the distinct minority with Israel standing alone. Can you foresee a diplomatic way to head this off at the pass?
Well, before it ever gets to the point where it's voted on, we should make very clear that if this outrageous insult to humanity and peace is actually presented for vote, the United States will withdraw not only its financial support for the UN and its participation, but it will either ask the UN to relocate to a country of its choice, or it will get jackhammers, saw the UN right off the shores of the East River and let it float to wherever it may land.
You really feel that strongly about it? You would do that as a leader? You would say that's what's at stake here? We feel that strongly about this?
Lisa, there's no point in trying to accommodate people who believe that an entire nation of individuals should be murdered. Hamas and the Palestinians have made it clear that they do not believe Israel has a right to exist. They believe that Jews should be killed. Now, that's their position. There's no way that you can accommodate that viewpoint. There has to be some walking back and some acknowledgement that Israel has a right to exist as a Jewish state. And if the Palestinians can't do that, then there's nothing to talk about and there's nothing to negotiate, nothing whatsoever.
Well, okay, I hope that somebody in the White House has your ear, Mike Huckabee. I really mean that.
I don't think they'll listen, but I wish they would.
I mean, I really, those are very strong statements, and they start from a position of great, you know, friendship and, you know, and loyalty to Israel. It makes my heart very glad to hear it, because I'm always feeling as a Jew that my motives are so mixed in with my own historical framework and background and knowledge and wanting Israel to thrive, that whenever I hear someone who isn't Jewish stand up and talk like this for Israel, it makes me very grateful. It really does. I feel that way, grateful. So, thank
you. Well, and Lisa, I would hope that that Christians would understand that if we do not stand with Israel, then the day will come when there will be no one left to stand with us. This is about freedom. It's about right versus wrong. It's about good versus evil. To me, this is not something that ought to be difficult for any of us. It ought to be a decision that we make out of conviction, a principle.
Governor Mike Huckabee, it's been so wonderful to have you on the show. I hope you're going to come back.
Love to do it. I look forward to doing it soon, Lisa. Thank you.